getting ready to go sailing, and we're super excited because we have 17 knots of true wind right now, which is a good Caribbean sailing day. Hey, Lenny and I had an amazing sailing discussion, and I think she might have hit a new gear in understanding sail trim and what we're doing on this boat, because this boat is quite different from all boats. It's going to be sporty, and we're going to get our speed up. The other thing is right now we're super light ship. We only have about 25% fuel in each tank. The holding tanks are empty. Our water tanks are down to like 30 gallons because this boat weighs about 40,000 pounds, but there's 8,000 pounds of fluids alone when you do full water, full fuel, full black gray water tanks. So when you want to go sailing, you want to take thousands of pounds off the boat. But right now we have the boat in really light ship condition. Plus there's just two of us. So headed into the wind, Lenny's gonna take the wheel and we are gonna raise the mast. So now let's go ahead and take out the jib. Successful hoist. Every time you raise the sails, there could be a little challenge. This roller furling boom is awesome. And so Lenny holds the button inside, I hold the winch button here, and then we just kind of observe as the sails go up. And then this strut right here, the boom has to be at 87 degrees to furl and unfurl, mostly to furl. But when the boom is at 87 degrees, it's like rolling off a sheet of wrapping paper. If you don't have it just right, it gets long on one end and it won't furl correctly in the boom. So anyway, we've really gotten good now at raising and lowering this thing correctly without drama. The jib obviously comes out easy. It's on a Reckman furler. You see that big electrical device there? So Lenny literally pushes a button inside the boat to let out the jib. And to sheet it in and out, there's buttons inside for that winch. So that's how easy this boat is to handle. So it's really set up for shorthanded cruising.
We just left Gorda Sound and we're doing 9 knots, but we're gonna luff up so we can lower one of the boards.
This is great practice for you, Ben. Look at that. Now go a little more into the wind. We want to go until that jib starts to flutter. Look, it's starting to flutter. See that?
Yeah.
You're taking pressure off the boat because you're turning into the wind a little bit. Take it up a little more. Take it to 30. There you go. Still a little pressure on that board. I probably should have taken it up. Now fall off.
Yeah.
So what we're doing is lowering the center boards on this boat. We've got boards that go down 11 feet, but that keeps the boat from sliding sideways, which is a common problem with cats. So you may look like you're sailing one direction, but the wind is pushing against your sails and you actually have leeway. This boat has a board that goes down 11 feet, digs into the water and stops that leeway. And remember, your rudders are brakes. Whenever you turn the wheel, it's like applying a brake.
Yeah.
So you want to try to sail with minimal wheel movement. Some people are just all over like this and you're just slowing the boat down every time. There you go. Look how stable she is. Now, this is where you feel that solidness of the carbon fiber, where both poles are like connected like steel. So now we're gonna go ahead and we've been sailing along now at 9.5 knots right now, 14 knots of wind. Just really smooth, awesome. And we're gonna go ahead and tack. And this boat is self-tacking. But that means the main is going to flop over on its own, but the jib is also going to flop over on its own. So when I cross over the center of the wind, we're going to raise the daggerboard on the one side, lower the daggerboard on the other. I'm going 9.5. So now I'm tacking the boat. Lenny's getting this on video. So all I'm doing is turning over the center of the wind. I'm raising my daggerboard on the one side. I'm lowering my daggerboard on the other. So this daggerboard is now up, that daggerboard is now down.
My head flies away.
plumbing problem. My hat blew off my head. I almost lost it.
We just noticed that the main halyard is a little loose. That happens sometimes in a jammer when you've been sailing to weather like that. So I need to get the proper sail shape. So Lenny's gonna take the boat off autopilot, luff up into the wind a little bit so I can tighten the main halyard. Can't tighten it when there's a lot of wind on it. Bring me up to about 20 degrees and drop the traveler to leeward a little bit, same time. Come up a little more.
Okay, you're at 49. Okay.
So we did the maneuver where we tightened the main halyard. Got the main good. So now we are going to pull out the J0 and furl away the head sail and have a bigger sail to reach with. The cockpit right now looks like spaghetti. And every time we do a maneuver, we clean it up. You know what I mean? So you don't want to get your feet caught around any of this stuff. Okay, now the J0's out, and we're gonna roll in the jib at the same time.
10-2.
What are you doing?
10 knots. So now we're doing 10 knots, the same wind angle. So Randy was right, we had the wrong head sail out. So the J0 is definitely pushing us harder.
So Lenny lowers the traveler here, because the sail's gotta go way out because the wind is behind us almost. So the traveler is this device that holds the sheet. So she's moving the sail that way. There you go. Let your main sheet go a little bit and watch your boat speed. That's good. Lenny is doing a phenomenal job helming today. The stuff I'm teaching her and the stuff she's working on is the stuff where you really take into account everything that's going on. Not just, hey babe, steer for this position or steer for that position or turn 90 degrees. Now it's all about riding the waves and feeling the wind and knowing how to depower the boat and power the boat up. And helmsmanship and sail trim go hand in hand. One is not more important than the other. But if I'm gonna be the trimmer, I need a good helms person, and she's doing it. Okay, this is awesome. As you can see, we know what to do, but since the boat is new, a lot of these processes are just a little new for us. But we're getting it, and we're doing it. So this is part of our B&G system, and this entire boat is B&G, Brooks and Gatehouse Electronics. And it's an entire suite with a ship computer. And there's four screens. This is the main glass cockpit. This is the Vesper VHF AIS with a handheld remote. This is a B&G autopilot. This is a second autopilot, completely separate drives, computers, and connections to the rudders. So if you're crossing an ocean, your autopilot goes down, you don't have to hand steer. You've got a backup. So we rotate back and forth. This is the B&G screen at the main helm. We usually have the chart here, and then we have sail steer, which is all the information you need for navigating the boat by sail, right? What's your average wind speed? What's your true wind speed? What's your speed over ground? What's the apparent wind angle? Where are my dagger boards? Right now they're up. And then earlier I talked about the weight of fluid. So there's a whole screen called fluid management. And as you can see, I'm down to 32 and 34% in my fuel tanks. My gray water tanks and my black water tanks are empty, and I've only got a little bit of fresh water. So we've lightened the boat by 4,000 or 5,000 pounds by not having a lot of fluid on board right now. Each aft station also has the chart, and it's got a camera showing the other side of the boat. So the theory is, if I'm standing here and I'm looking at the sails and I'm steering, I can't really see what's going on over there, but that camera on the side of the boat shows me if there's any collision or any other boats coming that direction. And I have all the buttons to control the sails from here as well. The other side of the boat has the same setup, because this is where you'd want to be to see your sail trim. That's kind of the normal position. But Lenny and I find that we're spending more time at this internal helm. And the reason is because it's next to the forward sailing cockpit where we're doing all of our pit work. So anyway, but that's the B&G electronic system. If you have any questions about that, drop a note in the comments. So I know this is mostly about sailing this new performance cat, but when you're a cruiser, you also have to do just a whole slew of different repairs and things like
well,
that.
Well, when you have a lot of toys.
Yeah,
which
most cruisers have a lot of toys. And so we got a hole in our paddleboard and we have to fix it now. So that's not near as exciting as sailing, but it's one of the things we have to do. And then this trip is like a 12-day trip, and we work on the boat every morning for probably 4 hours, would you say?
Yeah.
And of that 4 hours, we're talking to like refrigerator manufacturers, scuba compressor manufacturers, sail designers. There's just a list of things that either you have to figure out, you don't understand, or you have to tweak or change the installation method. And then sometimes you're just repairing a leak.
On a paddleboard.
On a paddleboard. Okay. I cannot get enough of watching this dinghy go down. Watch this. I put my foot on it. And that's it. The dinghy's launched. Quiet, fast, up and down, same speed. It's just amazing. It makes it really easy to use the dinghy. Watch the real estate increase. And that's it. That's one of my favorite items on the Kinetic. We haven't paddleboard in 3 years.
It's gonna go badly.
What do you mean? It's not gonna go badly.
No.
We rarely spend two nights in the same place, and we're doing it, and it's so lovely because we're doing things like paddle boarding. We just had a nice snorkel, and we put the shades down so the sun stays off the glass for the back of the boat because it gets really hot in there when the sun's shining in. So just a beautiful day here in the BVI. It's like riding a bike, except for not at all like riding a bike.
Riding a paddleboard.
But we did get our paddleboard legs back. So we went on this hike I might have mentioned this morning for 4 miles. And we came back and we walked down onto the dock. And there was this guy and his wife and his daughter and a friend. And anyway, his name is Colt, his wife Kelly. They have a catamaran here in the BVI called Peace Out. And he's been following our YouTube channel, or they have, for years. And it was just so fun to meet him. And we talked about, you know, the whole Happy Together community. And you know, he said he's been following us forever. He said he's never reached out, never emailed me. Here's the takeaway. If you watch this channel and you see us anywhere, please come up and talk to us, because it's the most fun thing we do is get to meet you guys and answer questions and you know, get to know people within the community. So it was really fun to meet Colt and Kelly, and we want to meet you too. I got my toes in the water, I'm passing the sand. I don't need a cold beer in my hand. Life is good today. Life is good today. Come on, dance. Adios and bye, Pendio. A long way from GA. And all the muchachas, they call me Big Papa. And I throw pesos their way. Adios and bye, Pendio. Away from GA. Hey buddy, do me a favor and pour me some Jaeger. I'll grab my guitar and so So now it's sunset, and I know we've seen a bunch of them, but they're never hard to look at. Look at this harbor. So it's 7 a.m. We just left Norman Island, and now we're heading to the Indians for a dive. Got to get here early because you have to mooring ball. There's no anchoring here. What we have here that's cool is we have a built-in mooring line. So instead of using dock lines, show what you got there.
It's my shackle, and the line goes through the mooring buckle, and then I just shackle it down. And then we have another one that's a secure, but we're not going to use it right now because it's a day stop. So double check me, Randy. I'm in.
Yep, you're in. Drop it.
And then we drop it. Good to go.
Now it's coffee time. You can hear it in my voice. I haven't had coffee yet. And then we scuba dive. Get ready. I nailed that.
You nailed that. That was perfect.
Yeah.
Now it just escalated, so.
There we go. Perfect. Thank you, brother. So it's our last day on this 2-week amazing sailing trip.
Yeah.
We feel really comfortable with the boat. Everything's going great. Oh, wow. Look at all the people.
So we got to the bubbly pool at the end of Joos Van Dyke, where Foxy Sabu is. And we've been here many times. It's not always this good, but there happens to be a north swell now, so it's really breaking. These are our friends that we met in Soggy Dollar yesterday. They are from Houston, I think. And they're followers, and they chartered sailboat out of St. Thomas, and they've brought their friends for the first time and they're having just a great time. So it's fun to meet them. Let's see what happens to Randy's hat. Not that good. Almost.
Sailing on this awesome trip, our final main sail hoist. Halfway up, so far so good.
So I'm steering the boat into the wind and I'm uncurling the curler and while Randy pulls up the sail, we've got a new system and it's working pretty good.
Now I'm just coming up to check it. Everything looks great. Now Lenny's gonna fall off the wind. She's gonna fall off the wind, and we're gonna get on our heading to the south end of the west end of Tortola. Now we're gonna go right past this motor yacht called Felix. It's 240 feet. And when we were on our hike this morning, we met the owner, just so happens. And one of his crew members or senior crew members is a guy who's been a captain on a boat that we've chartered before in the Med. So anyway, it was just a small world. He lives in Fort Lauderdale and we just met him on the trail today. So we are gonna pop the chute and show it to him as we go by him. And just like that, you fly the A2. Kill the engines. Do me a favor, bring the main in a little bit and as you tap down, look at your boat speed.
Wait, do we want a dagger?
Yeah, put a dagger board down on this side. Actually, no, just put it down like 50%. So that means we were too far out for the wind, too far in rather. Let it out some more, watch your boat speed. What's your apparent wind angle?
109.
So you're pretty much downwind, so the wind behind the boat, which is 13 knots, is down to apparent wind. What's your apparent wind? Apparent wind is 8, true wind speed? Yeah, so the true wind is 12, the apparent is 8, because we're sailing downwind, not our fastest sail. This sail's so big, Lenny's asking me to go make sure there's nobody on the other side of it. Now it's about sail trim. We've got to make sure that we can get...
Well, would you like to tell your helmsperson what wind angle would you like?
So my wind angle that I would like, helmsperson, right now is...
if this is my desired course right now...
The apparent wind is at 100 degrees, which is perfect for this sail. So why don't you sail the course... Why don't you steer the course you want, and I'll adjust the sails to it.
Okay, we're approaching our downwind mark, so we're going to roll away the AQ.
So we deployed the jib and tightened up the sails, and Lenny is doing all the helming because she is learning more about performance sailing, and she's learning more about helming, and she's doing a great job. You're like the helmsman. You're like Leona Helmsley. That was Emil DeMarco. I'm sure she had a lot of shoes, but I think it was tax evasion was her issue. She evaded taxes and bought shoes with the money? This is such an amazing place to helm from. I have perfect visibility of both sails and all the telltales, and I can see the gusts on the water and adjust my course to it. Really nice. After another great sailing day on our last day, the sea gods were merciless. My starboard engine won't start. And it'll be interesting. Could be that I ran it out of fuel, because this is a new boat. And the fuel tanks, you know, could need calibration, the sensors, whatever. It says I have 17%, so I should have about 24 gallons in that tank. But the test will be, I can pilot in on one engine, I have a bow thruster, and I know how to handle a cat, so I'm not worried about getting to the fuel dock. But the test will be to fill up the fuel and compare it to the capacity of the tank to see if that sensor was correct. So that's our challenge right now, heading into the fuel dock with one engine. I don't do a lot of things well, but driving a catamaran I do well. If I do say so myself. A little easier with a bow thruster.